Welcome to the Back to the Forties podcast. We are a group of recovered alcoholics who love sharing the history of the AA program. We are students of the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. We really believe in the program outlined in the book and want to share it with anyone who may be afflicted with the disease of alcoholism. These five classes will take us through the 12 steps right out of the Big Book as they did in the early days of AA. If you want more information about these classes, please email us at backtothe40s@gmail.com. That's backtothe40s@gmail.com. Or visit backtothe40s.podbean.com. That's backtothe40s.podbean.com. In this week's class, we reference an inventory worksheet that is available on our website for download for free. Please visit backtothe40s.podbean.com. This inventory worksheet is right out of the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous, and it provides a great guide to help with the fourth step inventory process. So grab your Big Book, your inventory worksheets, and let's join Michael, Mick, and Bob as they get Class 3 rolling.
Good morning. I'm an alcoholic. My name is Michael.
I'm Michael.
I am a recovered alcoholic, contingent on the maintenance of my spiritual condition daily. Let's have a moment of silence to reflect upon why we're here, followed by the Serenity Prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. We'd like to welcome you to the third class of the beginners' meetings of Alcoholics Anonymous, worked in the mid-1940s. More than 60 years ago, after the publication of the Big Book, the recovery rate from alcoholism within the fellowship of AA was at about 75%. AA's program is practiced then was quite different from the program that is practiced today. That is, the AA program is unchanged, but the way it is practiced has changed. To produce such an astounding recovery rate, what was done in the early days of AA? Well, this is what we're going to do. We're going to take an in-depth look at how Alcoholics Anonymous worked in the mid-40s. And I've asked Mick to read the AA preamble as it appeared in the first edition of the Big Book, and it reads,
"We are not an organization in the conventional sense of the word. There are no fees or dues whatsoever. The only requirement for membership is the honest desire to stop drinking. We are not allied with any particular faith, sect, or denomination. Nor do we oppose anyone. We simply wish to be helpful to those who are afflicted."
Hello, our names are Bob,
Michael,
Mick,
and we are recovered alcoholics, and that is contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition daily. We are not experts, nor are we authorities on the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous, and we are recovered alcoholics who love to study the Big Book. Any commentary that is made throughout this study is just our opinions based upon our interpretation of the Big Book. We don't need to open our books at this time, but we will let you know. On page 164 of the Big Book, it reads,
"Our book is meant to be suggestive only. We realize we know only a little. God will constantly disclose more to you and to us."
Before we begin this class, we'll need to address one more thing. There is always going to be controversy when it comes to this book and its message, for one reason or another. Some will say it needs to be rewritten, changed, or updated. And then there is the God issue, that it is written in the male gender, and a whole lot of other controversial issues. It's as if we are saying, the book should be changed to meet our personal agendas. On page Roman numeral 11, the book tells us,
"There exists a sentiment against any radical changes being made in it."
The point is, let's leave the book alone and change our own attitudes towards the book, and from that perspective, learn the recovery program that produced a 75% success rate back in the 1940s. This is how the presentation of these classes will work.
I will read from the 1944 pamphlet. We can listen to what is being read, take notes, and if you have any questions, write them down. Submit them to your sponsor or see one of us after the meeting to discuss them at length.
I will read excerpts from the Big Book and you will follow along using the line bookmark.
I will read commentary to what is studied and give directions, page numbers, line numbers, or paragraph numbers. This is how these classes are taught. Now listen carefully as Michael reads a very interesting item.
This is class three, and this is taken from the original log of the USS Constitution. On August 23rd, 1779, she set sail from Boston with 475 officers and men, 48,600 gallons of fresh water, 77,400 cannon shot, 11,600 pounds of black powder, and 79,000 gallons of rum. Permission to harass and destroy English shipping was given, and she headed for Jamaica. Arriving in Jamaica on October 5th, she took on 825 pounds of flour and 68,300 gallons of rum. She'd been sailed at sea 67 days. She sailed toward the Azores, arriving on November 12, 1779. She was loaded there with 550 pounds of beef and 54,300 gallons of Portuguese wine. She'd been at sea 37 days. On November 18, she set sail for England. In the ensuing days, she defeated five British men of war and captured and scuttled 12 English merchantmen, salvaging 70,000 gallons of rum. By January 27th, her powder and shot were exhausted. Unarmed, she made a night raid up the Firth of Clyde. Her landing party captured a whiskey distillery and transferred 40,000 gallons of whiskey aboard by dawn. She'd been at sea 70 days. Then she headed for home. The USS Constitution arrived in Boston in February of 1780 with no food, no cannon shot, no powder, no rum, no whiskey, no wine, and 48,600 gallons of stagnant water.
Before we get into the steps 6, 7, 8, and 9, the restitution phase, we're going to study and take a mock fourth step, a trial run at the fourth step. Please raise your hand if you need a copy of the fourth step packet. The fourth step is simple. All we are doing is the step is answering some questions, writing the answers down in an inventory fashion, reading some information from the big book, reaching a few conclusions, saying a few prayers, reconsidering our personal positive positions on resentments, fears, and our conduct over the years past, saving the inventory for future use, and doing all this with the guidance of a sponsor, following the directions from the big book.
This fourth step is not the fifth step. It is not a psychological exam or a graded test. It is not an endeavor to beat yourself up by wallowing in the past, or a step that requires a lot of time. If it is not perfect in every way, a self-destructive venture, a pity party, nor is it an autobiography, a novel of your whole life story. The fourth step is a fact-finding, spiritual search for the truth. That's all, nothing more, nothing less. Let's break this step down to an understandable basic layout.
Number one.
With the guidance of a sponsor, read the big book, page 63, last paragraph, up to and including page 71.
Number two.
Make several copies each of the inventory worksheets.
Number three.
Answer the questions in an inventory fashion vertically, one column at a time, following the instructions on the worksheets, in accordance with the directions from the big book until completed.
Number four.
When you are finished with the fourth step, save it. Move on to the fifth step.
Let's take a look at the inventory worksheets and take a mock fourth step. So if you look at where it says resentments, look for column one, let's follow along as Bob reads the first statement.
Hi, I'm Bob. In dealing with resentments, we set them down on paper. We listed people, institutions, or principles with whom we were angry. Big book, page 64.
We will need to find out what people, institutions, or principles mean. In a brief and simple way, let's take a look at these three components that are used throughout the four step. People. Now that would be any human being. And it says, etc.
Like Bob.
Institutions. Any establishment, organization, facility, practice, system, incorporation, etc. Principles. Any fundamental, original, ultimate, natural, essential, spiritual, truth, law, theory, doctrine, rule, method, motivating force upon which others are based. You've been supplied with information pertaining to these definitions and also some lists of helpful terms. These sheets will help you in taking the fourth step. This is supplied in your packet.
In looking at column one, can you think of a person with whom you are angry? If so, write the name in the block. So all you need to do at this point in the process is to go back through your life and think of all the people who have made you resentful and put one name to each block. Then, when you run out of blocks in column one, you start a new sheet and continue to fill it out. Repeat this until you are finished finding people in your past or present using column number one only.
Then we move on to institutions. We do exactly the same process that we just covered. Go back through your life and look for institutions with whom you were angry. Put this information in column number one also. And finally, for column number one, we do precisely the same thing with principles.
If this was a real fourth step, we would have a stack of inventory worksheets for resentments with column number one filled to the max with names of people, titles of institution, and terms of principles. Keep in mind that we are going to have leftovers that we forget to list. We will take care of them later on in step 10, so don't wallow around wasting time.
Before we go any further, we need to explain this inventory process one column at a time, vertically. And if you're smart like me, that means up and down. No matter how intelligent or mentally coordinated we are, people simply do a more thorough searching, less confusing, honest job when they keep it simple. The Big Book tells us on page 23, quote, "The main problem centers in his mind rather than his body," end quote. And if this is true, then we had better keep an open mind and try to follow some directions. Let's move on.
Column number two, as in column number one, is to be completed in the same manner. In an inventory fashion, vertically, one column at a time. In looking at column number two, can you think of the reason why you were angry? At the items in column number one, again, as in column number one, go back through your life and answer this question, a block at a time. Now, in column number three, the only thing we do differently is place a check mark in the appropriate block. Keep in mind that not every person, institution, or principle will relate to all the injuries across the board.
Let's continue to move forward into the solution. At the bottom left portion of this page, we are directed to number four, which reads, "Four, we went back through our lives. Nothing counted but thoroughness and honesty. When we were finished, we considered it carefully. Remember that it's progress, not perfection. And participate, don't anticipate." Next, we read and follow along from the Big Book, page 65, line 13, which is found on the next inventory worksheet, Resentments, page number 2. What we are about to study is the precise information that we need to consider carefully.
This is out of the Big Book, pages 65, 66, and 67. The problem is explained. The first thing apparent was that this world and its people were often quite wrong. To conclude that others were wrong was as far as most of us ever got. The usual outcome was that people continued to wrong us and we stayed sore. Sometimes it was remorse and then we were sore at ourselves. Here's a warning. But the more we fought and tried to have our own way, the worse matters got.
In war, the victor only seemed to win. Our moments of triumph were short-lived. It is plain that all life, which includes deep resentment, leads only to futility and unhappiness.
And here's another warning. To the precise extent that we permit these, do we squander the hours that might have been worthwhile?
But with the alcoholic, whose hope is the maintenance and growth of a spiritual experience, this business of...
And here's another warning. This business of resentment is infinitely grave. We found that it is fatal.
For when harboring such feelings, we shut ourselves off from the sunlight of the spirit. The insanity of alcohol returns and we drink again.
And here's another warning. And with us, to drink is to die.
If we were to live, we had to be free of anger. The grouch and the brainstorm were not for us. There may be the dubious luxury for normal men, but for alcoholics, these things are poison.
The solution is given. We must accept and change our attitudes and rely on God.
We turned back to the list, for it held the key to the future. We were prepared to look for it with an entirely different angle. We began.
Now remember, resentment is wrong judgment.
To see that the world and its people were really dominated us, in that state, the wrongdoing of others, fancied or real, had power to actually kill. How could we escape? We saw that these resentments must be mastered, but how? We could not wish them away any more than alcohol.
The action we must take and not take.
This was our course. We realized that the people who wronged us were perhaps spiritually sick. Though we did not like their symptoms and the way they disturbed us, they, like ourselves, were sick too.
There's a prayer.
We ask God to help us show them the same tolerance, pity, and patience that we would cheerfully grant a sick friend. When a person offended us, we said to ourselves,
there's another prayer.
This is a sick man. How can I be helpful to him? God, save me from being angry. Thy will be done.
Now here's a warning.
We avoid retaliation or argument. We wouldn't treat sick people that way. If we do, we destroy our chance of being helpful. We cannot be helpful to all people, but at least...
And the bottom line is...
Resentment is the number one offender. It destroys more alcoholics than anything else. From it stems all forms of spiritual disease. For we have been not only mentally and physically ill, we have been spiritually sick.
And now, the four-step promise. And it reads, when a spiritual malady is overcome, we straighten out mentally and physically.
Resentment is wrong judgment or wrong judging on our part. Consider this, 95% of what put us here never happened. And if it did happen to us, it doesn't matter. What really matters is what we do with it or about it while it is happening to us. And after it happens to us, what did we do? We got angry and resentful and stayed that way. Now in the next portion of the process, we will explore the exact nature of our wrongs. This takes place in columns 4 and 5. Let's take a look.
Go to page 3. It reads Resentments Inventory. That's page 3, big book, page 67. By using the information from columns 1, 2, and 3, we continue to move forward into the solution by answering. Continue from page 1, columns 1 and 3, column 4 on the inventory worksheet. Where had we been selfish, dishonest, self-seeking, and frightened? In other words, after considering the information in columns 1, 2, and 3, and looking at this through the conclusion we have drawn, by reading the pages from the big book, we should now have a different perspective, a clear understanding, and are armed with the facts about our position. We should now agree with the following.
Somewhere along the way in life, we as alcoholics became warped. The things that were instinctual, natural, and good to us got perverted somehow. We went through life with wrong judgments, wrong believing, and wrong actions. If people, institution, or principles did not satisfy us, please us, meet our conditions, our expectations, our agenda threatened us, intimidated, or to hurt us, we punished them or acted out the role of the victim. We were afraid to appear that we had anything wrong with us, that we had any problems. We would find a good reason for why we were right or why people, institutions, or principles were wrong. Because we'd rather not be wrong, it's that simple. Let's move on. Begin with the top right of page 3, resentments.
Referring to our list again, putting out of our minds the wrongs others had done, we resolutely looked at our own mistakes. Where have we been selfish, dishonest, self-seeking, and frightened? Though a situation had not been entirely our fault, we tried to disregard the other person involved entirely. Where were we to blame? The inventory was ours, not the other man's. When we saw our faults, we listed them. We placed them before us in black and white. We admitted our wrongs honestly and were willing to set these matters straight. Go to the column number 4. Answer column number 4 in an inventory fashion. When finished, move on to column number 5. Where were we to blame? Our wrongs, our faults, our own mistakes.
By this time, you ought to have a real good understanding of how to do the fourth step inventory process. Let's continue and listen to this panel's mock example of the resentment worksheet in its entirety. Remembering we do columns vertically, one at a time. Column number 1, I'm resentful at people, Dad, Robert. And column number 2 is the cause. He wasn't around when I needed him. He had very little time or attention for me. Column number 3, it affects my put check marks in security, ambitions, personal relations, and pride. In column number 4, in the question, where had I been? I had been selfish, dishonest, self-seeking, and frightened in my attitudes, the way I treated, and the ways I avoided, and the ways I tried to get even with my father. He was wrong, I was right. Column number 5, where was I to blame? I would come up with an alibi, real or imagined, so I wouldn't spend time with him when he did try to do so with me. I blamed him for everything wrong in my life. I drank to oblivion and stayed resentful. I never tried to work things out with him.
Here's an example of institutions. The same process. Column number 1, I'm resentful at, and the institution we picked was Catholic school. Column number 2, the cause. Too many rules and regulations. It was no fun. Teachers were unfair. The students made fun of me. Column number 3. This is the check marks. It affects my self-esteem, my security, ambitions, personal relation, pride. Column number 4. Where had I been? I was selfish, dishonest, self-seeking, and frightened by my irresponsible, immature, and defiant attitudes and actions. I treated fellow students, teachers, assignments, rules, and regulations with total disregard and adversity. Column number 5, where I take responsibility. Where was I to blame? Well, I wasted time, resources, and took everything for granted. I lived by my own agenda. I was lazy. I drank at school and abused, manipulated, and broke the rules on purpose. I was a professional victim and victimizer.
Here's an example of the principles. In column number 1, I'm resentful at competition. Column number 2, the cause, I was never good enough. It was always embarrassing and too challenging. I feared confrontation and exposure. I hated to lose. In column number 3, it affected my pocketbook, self-esteem, security, ambitions, personal relations, and my pride. Column number 4, where had I been? I was selfish, dishonest, self-seeking, and frightened by being passive and aggressive. I lived the role of the victim and the victimizer. My agendas, wants, and desires were based upon ignorance and contempt. I lived a fear-based life serving only one thing, me. Column number 5, where was I to blame? I would lie and cheat so I could win. I would either rule, run, or hide, or stay and fight. I'd never compromise. I was full of fear. I was always talking in the talks, never walking the walk. I anticipated, hardly ever participated. I was two-faced, an actor. I drank over it to escape or to deal with it.
Let's move on to fears. Keep in mind that this meeting is not a question and answer forum. If you do have some questions, write them down and submit them to your sponsor. Go to the fear inventory, page 4. The big book simplifies everything when it comes to our fears. See if you can draw some conclusions about your position on fears as we read.
Fear. Big book, page 67 and 68.
This short word somehow touches about every aspect of our lives. It was an evil and corroding thread. The fabric of our existence was shot through with it. It set in motion trains of circumstances which brought us misfortunes we felt we didn't deserve, but did not we ourselves set the ball rolling. Sometimes we think fear ought to be classed with stealing. It seems to cause more trouble.
directions for the fear inventory.
We reviewed our fears thoroughly. We put them on paper. Even though we had no resentment in connection with them, we asked ourselves why we had them.
The action we must take and not take. The solution is given. Accept and change our attitudes and rely upon God.
Wasn't it because self-reliance failed us? Self-reliance was good as far as it went, but it didn't go far enough. Some of us once had great self-confidence, but it didn't fully solve the fear problem, or any other. When it made us cocky, it was worse. Perhaps there's a better way. We think so.
The bottom line is, fear is wrong believing. Let's continue if we have taken steps 1, 2, and 3.
For now, we are on a different basis, the basis of trusting and relying upon God. We trust infinite God rather than our finite selves. We are in the world to play the role He assigns, just to the extent that we do as we think we should have, He should have us, and humbly rely on Him. Does He enable us to match calamity with serenity?
There's another warning.
We never apologize to anyone for depending upon our Creator. We can laugh at those who think spirituality is the way of weakness. Paradoxically, it is the way of strength. The verdict of the ages is that faith means courage. All men of faith have courage. They trust their God. We never apologize for God. Instead, we let Him demonstrate through us what He can do.
And here's a prayer.
We ask Him to remove our fear and direct our attention to what He would have us to be. At once, we commence to outgrow fear.
The kind of fears that the four-step inventory process deals with are a specific kind of fear. All human beings have fears, instinctual fears, that we are all born with. These fears are reasonable. They motivate us and protect us. The fears that we need to consider in step 4 are the kind that stifle us, that destroy us. The kind of fears that we are taught and instilled with, homegrown fears. They are lies that we tell ourselves and or have been told, and also the denial of the truth, a definite wrong believing that's designed to destroy and or kill us. So basically, we need to look at the wrong believing and the lies and denials that we have been living with and throughout our alcoholic's career and lives. Here are some examples of the kind of fears that we are talking about.
Now, whether it be a person, institution, or principle, have you ever made statements or perhaps had these kind of conversations with yourself? And they are, what are they going to do with me? What's going to happen if I do that? Poor me. Why me? I can't. I'll never make it. I'd never survive that. I'm no good, loser. I'll show you a thing or two. And that's beneath me. I refuse to do it. Oh God, what if I lose my job? How would I ever make it? Fear is cunning, baffling, and powerful. We must review them and get them on paper and honestly face them. Let's go to page 5 of the inventory worksheet, column 1, and answer the statement. We reviewed our fears thoroughly.
Go back through your life and think of any people, institutions, or principles that you fear. Put those items in column number 1, and in column number 2, answer accordingly. The question, why we had them. One column at a time, one item at a time, vertically, until columns number 1 and number 2 are completed. Listen as we read from our mock examples of the Fears Inventory Worksheet.
This is out of the Fears Inventory Worksheet, out of the big book, pages 67 and 68. It says, column number 1, we reviewed our fears thoroughly. And this is people, childhood bully, Danny Diamond. Column 2, we asked ourselves why we had them, these fears. What will he do to me if he catches me? What will everyone think and say about me if he beats me up? I'm a coward, a weakling, and no good. I'll never survive this. I'm going to go back to column number 1 for institutions. And it, when we picked those prisons, in column 2, it says, what would happen to me there? Will they beat me? Rape me? What else? Mm-hmm. What about all the other things people tell you about? I'd never make it. I'll die there for sure. Mm-hmm. back to column one, principles, the Ten Commandments. And in column two, it says, I'll go to hell for all eternity if I break them and sin. I'll be punished and have to live the rest of my life in a living hell. I'm a bad person and God will hate me if I break them. I must be perfect or else.
Fear is silly. It's in our heads. It's wrong believing. It's believing a lie. It's denying the truth. It is relying on self rather than relying on God. Pray, P-R-A-Y, or be pray, P-R-E-Y. Our ideas did not work, but the God idea did. Our troubles, we think, are of our own making. Selfishness, self-centeredness, that we think is the root of our own troubles. We can now see how ridiculous our alcoholic fears are and have been. Fear is simple. Alcoholics are complicated.
There are many kinds of harms done that we have incurred over the years past. Sex is one of them. It is singled out because it is an instinctual, controversial, and above all else, it is the common ground for all alcoholics, all human beings. The whole point is told to us in the Big Book when it comes to our own conduct over the years past. It tells us, in other words, we treat sex as we would any other problem. With any harmful conduct, we apply the solution from the pages of the Big Book. Let's move on to page number one, sex inventory.
It's six.
I'm sorry, six.
Six, sex. Six, sex.
The problem is explained. The bottom line. Now, about sex. Many of us need an overhauling there. But above all, we try to be sensible on this question. It's so easy to get way off track here. Here we find human opinions running to extremes, absurd extremes, perhaps. One set of voices cry that sex is the lust of our lower nature, but a bare necessity of procreation. Then we have the voices who cry for sex and more sex, who bewail the institution of marriage, who think that most of the troubles of the race are traceable to their sex causes. They think we do not have enough of it, or that it isn't the right kind. They see its significance everywhere. One school would allow man to flavor for his fare, and the other would have us all on a straight pepper diet. We want to stay out of this controversy. We do not want to be the arbiter of anyone's sex conduct. We all have sex problems. We'd hardly be humans if we didn't. But what can we do about them?
The directions are given.
We reviewed our own conduct over the years past. Where had we been selfish, dishonest, or inconsiderate? Whom had we hurt? Did we unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness? Where were we at fault? What should we have done instead? We got this all down on paper and looked at it. In this way, we tried to shape a sane and sound idea for our future sex life. We subjected each relation to this test. Was it selfish or not?
The solution is given. There's a prayer. Because we must change our attitudes and our conduct, our actions.
We ask God to mold our ideals and help us to live up to them. We remember always that our sex powers were God-given and therefore good. Neither to be used lightly or selfishly, nor to be despised or loathed.
And here's a warning.
Whatever our ideals turned out to be, we must be willing to grow toward it. We must be willing to make amends where we have done harm, provided that we do not bring about still more harm in so doing. In other words, we treat sex as we would any other problem.
And here's a prayer.
In meditation, we ask God what we should do about each specific matter. The right answer will come if we want.
But here's a warning.
God alone can judge our sex situation. Counsel with persons is often desirable, but we let God be the final judge. We realize that some people are as fanatical about sex as others are loose. We avoid hysterical thinking or advice.
There's another warning.
Suppose we fall short of the chosen ideal and stumble. Does this mean we are going to get drunk? Some people tell us so, but this is only a half-truth. It depends on us and our motives.
And then here's another prayer.
If we are sorry for what we have done and have the honest desire to let God take us to better things, we believe we will be forgiven and we'll have learned our lesson.
Here's a warning. If we are not sorry and our conduct continues to harm others, we are quite sure to drink. We are not theorizing. These are facts out of our experience. To sum up about sex, and here's another prayer.
We earnestly pray for the right ideal, for guidance in each questionable situation, for sanity, and for the strength to do the right thing.
And the cure-all is?
If sex is very troublesome, we throw ourselves the harder into helping others. We think of their needs and work for them. This takes us out of ourselves. It quiets the imperious urge when it yields would mean heartache.
Let's move on in the inventory worksheet to page 7, and this is right out of the big book, page 69.
We reviewed our own conduct over the years past. We got this all down on paper and looked at it.
Again, keeping in line with the directions, we answer one column at a time, vertically, thinking of people, institution, or principles. In an inventory fashion, we consider column 1. It asks, column number 1, where have we been selfish, dishonest, or inconsiderate? We wrote down the family, bank, and marriage. Column number 2, whom did we hurt? Mom, Dorothy. Manager, Bill. Wife, Donna. Column number 3, did we unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, and bitterness? Yes, bitterness and suspicion. Yes, bitterness. Yes, all of the above. Number 4, where had we been at fault? First column, I stole and forged checks in the amount of $250. I lied about it and never paid her back. The bank jeopardized his job by manipulating our friendship to get cash advances on a credit card. I lied. Our marriage ruined the marriage. Lied, stole $1,000, cheated, led her on, used her, abused our friendship, and drank throughout. And then column number 5, what should we have done instead? Paid my own debts and consequences. Sober, responsible son. Paid back the $250 and apologized. Used the card reasonable. Apologize and respect the friendship. Column number 5. Stayed sober. No marriage, just friends. Apologize and pay back the $1,000.
Consider this equation to step 4. An alcoholic minus alcohol equals an ick. Ick is described as being what we alcoholics are left with when we get to step 4, which is that we are abstinent, but still, according to the big book throughout, unmanageable, powerless, insane, beyond human aid, obsessive, vain, abnormal, bodily, mentally different, delusional, and many other things. The whole problem comes down to this. In step 4, we did and probably still have wrong judgment, wrong believing, and wrong actions. Until we take ourselves through the rest of the 12 steps, we are simply living with untreated alcoholism, and we'll try the old game again.
You should now have an understanding of who, what, when, where, how, and why of the fourth step and its directions from the big book. A definite and valuable example of the inventory process. If you're still confused or perhaps just not sure, keep coming back. Remember, it's not important that you feel great and totally grasp step 4 in order to complete it. Take a risk and see what happens. We learn by doing, not by feeling, and hopefully you'll be amazed before you are halfway through. It's quality, not quantity, progress, not perfection. We must be rigorously honest, or we become rigorously mortis.
We have been thorough about our personal inventory. We have written down a lot. We have listed and analyzed our resentments. We have begun to comprehend their futility and their fatality. We have commenced to see their terrible destructiveness. We have begun to learn tolerance, patience, and goodwill towards all men, even our enemies, for we look back on them as sick people. We have listened to people we have hurt by our conduct and are willing to straighten out the past if we can. In this book, if you read again and again that fate did for us what we could not do for ourselves, we hope you are convinced now that God can remove whatever self-will has been blocked you off from Him. If you have already made a decision and an inventory of your grosser handicaps, you have made a good beginning. That being, so you have swallowed and digested some big chunks of truth about yourself.
Thank you. This is the end of class 3. Next week, we will move on to step 6, 7, 8, and 9. Don't forget to breathe. Thanks.
Thank you for taking the time to listen to our podcast. We are a regular meeting that meets on Saturday mornings at 9 a.m. in Tacoma, Washington. We are at the First Congregational Church on the corner of Division and I Street. If you're ever in the neighborhood, we'd love to have you stop by. We close the meeting by observing the seventh tradition. We stand, we bow our heads. We do not hold hands, nor do we say any sayings or slogans. We just use the Lord's Prayer followed by a moment of silence. Again, thank you for taking the time to listen.